Το πάρω. Ευχαριστώ. Καλημέρα. Καλησπέρα και από μένα. Καλημέρα. Γιατί λέω και πέρα καλημέρα. Γιατί είμαι πρωινός, ε. Λοιπόν, θα το κάνω την εισαγωγή στα... I will be in Greek for the introduction and then... θα κάνω την εισαγωγή στα ελληνικά, θα το γυρίσουμε μετά στα αγγλικά γιατί έχουμε τον κύριο Κέλλη και προτίμησα να μην την κάνουμε στα ελληνικά για να μπορεί να γίνει πιο εύκολο απάνω. Το θέμα είναι τεχνολογία και blockchain τώρα. Το blockchain που κολλάει θα μας πούνε εδώ οι ειδικοί. Εσείς κύριε καθηγητά μην γελάτε από τώρα γιατί έχουμε μετά. Και θα ήθελα να συστηθώ. Είμαι ο Δημήτρης Μαλάς. Είμαι στο συνεργάτη στο banks.com.gr. Όπως είπε ο Χρήστος Κόνστας, ο οποίος έφυγε, δεν ξέρω τίποτα από τεχνολογία. Οπότε θα προσπαθήσω να κάνω μια ζήτηση που δεν θα είναι τεχνολογία. Αλλά μέχρι εκεί πέρα. I said that we'll make a discussion that won't be in technology, but we have to talk about technology. So, what I'm going to do is start with you, Mr. Kelly, about what you have shown. Just to summarize that. What you more or less said, at least that's what I understood. If I understood wrongly, you can correct me. That's the reason. Is that technology and blockchain, a second chance, can help you provide more transparency for the corporate governance first, but also it can give you access to the retail investors that can have more access to the corporation. Am I right about that or wrong?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. I think, like you say, it gives more transparency, easier transparency for more investors, not just the richest institutional investors. And it reduces friction, you might say, between the investor and the issuer in the governance process.
Have you seen that abroad?
I'd say we've seen it slowly, just more generally. So we, but often it's regulatory driven, particularly if you're talking about you know, the core aspect of governance is voting.
Yeah.
and voting is defined very closely by what the regulation says. We've seen some issuers who've been really proactive in making voting easier, but ultimately they're still limited by regulation. But I would say over time, just as more investors want to vote, that's tended to make it cheaper for everyone anyway.
Okay, I will ask the professor here. How do you, in your sense, I want a general comment from the rest of the three of you. How do you see that technology can help corporate governance better? Can influence that, can change that?
Look, first, irrespective of blockchain.
It's not just blockchain, we'll come to blockchain.
Let's start with technology in general and a little bit more than technology. You see, where I'm coming from, is a place that usually we say, and this is governments, we say governments will learn from the private sector. Especially here in Greece, we say that maybe too much. Say, government needs to know what to do. Okay, this is true for many aspects of the Greek public sector, but Greece is just one country out of the 200 so. So think about it, governments have some very strong lessons to give to private enterprises if needed.
Is that the case here?
First, no, I'm not talking about here. We're speaking in English, we are international, these are international companies. Don't think about the Greek government.
No, I'm talking about corporate governance.
Governments, and then governance. Think about it. Countries are big organizations. Even Greece has 600,000 employees. You know,
that's the largest okay.
This is the size of Volkswagen. This is the size of IBM. IBM is even smaller now. So first, these are big, huge service machines. Secondly, you know, I don't want to be rude today, especially to people coming from UK, but you see, governments and countries never shut down.
Yeah.
How about that? Even Greece, with our problems and our issues, there's no way that you can shut down a country unless you do something very, very radical, which is not the case, I think, anymore. And third, and most importantly, maybe, countries share much easier than companies. Imagine, maybe Google, maybe Amazon, maybe, you know, think about every big organization in the private sector. Maybe they solve an issue with blockchain or without in digital transformation? Do you think they will tell us? Do you think they will publish it and say, hey, hey, this is our solution on things?
While a government has to do that.
Governments do that. I'm working with European Commission for years now. There is a huge amount of knowledge, wisdom, I might say, on what European Commission publishes about things like interoperability, like blockchain, like artificial intelligence, how these technologies change organizations like Germany, the state of Germany, like France, like Greece, like Italy, like Estonia, like Georgia, and now we move to blockchain, if you want. I mean,
let's finish with that. We'll come back to blockchain because there's a lot of talk about blockchain. Okay, so the general comment, he puts it, I think professor here puts it in a different perspective than I thought, but
I
that was
say,
interesting.
Because I'm coming, like, same from the banking sector, I work
okay,
for
so we have
years.
Government, banking, let's okay. Don't talk about
I
banking.
Can tell you that technology is something that try to help corporate governance. On the other hand, it's something that also putting a lot of trouble for the corporate itself, because in order all this technology and all these funny things or peculiar things that the managers, they don't know very well, in order to put all together and to have them operational, first of all, you have to go back and do a re-engineering of your processes in order, let's say, to accommodate the capabilities
so
of the
So what we're talking about in digital transformation in general, also if we want to use technology for corporate governance, there should be a change of procedures, a change of culture, a change
or
of mind.
Or at least adaptation of procedures in many cases. If we're speaking about banks because they have...
The procedures of corporate governance have to adapt to technology or technology have to adapt to corporate governance?
Both ways.
Both ways?
Both ways.
Okay.
For sure, but I can tell you that in many cases, when I was working for the banks, the corporate governance is putting some bias that technology couldn't... let's say
that's the regulated part that was he said. So the regulation also has to change there in order to adapt.
Yes, and if we are speaking about blockchain or whatever it's related to new technologies, it doesn't mean that the legislation that is governing even banks, it does not help in many ways that we can incorporate that in the operations of the company.
Okay, Mr. Karmanoulis, your thoughts about that? So in order to start a conversation, because starting to put some stuff together.
Okay, here is an example from the government sector, and I'm very proud of it. I was one of the implementers and designers 10 years ago. It is the Clarity Transparency Project, the Avia in Greece. And okay, how this project product of in order to support transparency in every public organization works. Every decision, every public spending, even if you want to buy a pencil, is uploaded on the internet. And if this decision is not uploaded in the internet, then it is illegal. It cannot be executed. So we can imagine how this example of to implement radical transparency or technologically driven transparency projects could support the private sector in terms of, for example, εμπιστοσύνη.
Trust.
In terms of trust, when we were discussing the previous panel about the China business model. Okay, the Chinese business model from the Greek entrepreneurs. So, okay, public and private sector are very different, but blockchain technology enable the organization to externalize internal processes and data.
Okay,
we'll come back to blockchain. In a way that the previous speaker...
Okay, just to understand something, okay, because now I'm also trying to understand. Professor was talking about that the private sector can take lessons from the public sector. The Avia could be one example like that, to how to use technology in order to provide more transparency.
If you want to do that, yes, it could be. I would very much like to see the Avia in a Greek bank.
Yeah, me too, that's also.
It is something that is discussed.
Well, it is discussed.
It is discussed in European level.
It's a Greek word. I don't know if you understand
clarity,
the concept.
Clarity in English.
It's clarity in English. Okay, so it's a service that all the public sector authorities have to publish everything. to publish that online. So
all the decisions.
Yeah. All the decisions, yeah.
Administrative and financial.
So, okay, let's ask now down. Will you in your companies go for a Diavia stuff? That will be easy for you? That's my question.
I can tell you that. Let me tell you.
In the National Bank of Greece that you were what? It was easy to do that?
Well, I was working for National Bank of Greece, and I can tell you that if we are speaking 10 years ago, the whole procurement process, as we speak, because we are speaking about procurement,
because mainly it's the procurement.
Different from the one that I've shown the, for the last, let's say, 5 years.
Yeah,
the whole because the corporate governance and the legislation that came in effect obliged, let's say, the whole management to build new procedures to re-engineer the whole process and to make it more, let's say, open and transparent to the rest of the company.
Okay, Mr. Kelly, that scheme could be practical in general terms, in your opinion?
Well, I think there's been lots of good points raised.
I'm going to change the point, don't worry, just to close that.
Yeah. So to close that one off, do I think it can be practical? I think there's lots of similar processes, maybe not quite as robust. But if you think about banks, most international banks who do any activity in the US are subject to Sarbanes-Oxley, of course, and they have their own procedures and controls for auditing similar kind of purchasing decisions and other sort of accountability. So it's not like those don't exist. And I think it's interesting how that's moved on, not just that legislation, there's lots of legislation for tracking those kind of decisions. More and more private enterprises will take technology to do that from vendors. They'll select the best from them, which is a great way of sharing best practice amongst different private corporations. Mm. So the idea that private companies don't share anything, I think, first of all, they share them by being smaller units, perhaps, but also they do share them. I mean, if you think about artificial intelligence, Google released a huge competition, huge report recently on the use of AI for social purpose. So I think companies, yeah, of course, they have more barriers to sharing some of that technology progress. And also, in terms of learning from best practice from public companies, I think you can learn from that. But the best companies, perhaps that's a bit pejorative, but certainly there are a number of companies now who have innovation labs, who understand how to innovate, how to look what's out there and learn from best practice. And that's a great kind of structure within a company to start to do that. So obviously not all companies do it, but I think more and more companies do look at what's out there. They do have bureaucratic structures in place to make sure that they can exploit those new technologies to the benefit of the company, and I think they do share information.
So. Okay. So thanks. Sorry, yeah. Now go to blockchain. How blockchain can help corporate government?
Mm-hmm. Just to link with a previous issue, in order to give something which I think will be in a proper setup for homework for the people.
Also,
we
have to ask
listening.
Them if how many people know about blockchain.
Just to finish the previous about the Avia and the Clarity.
The best practice.
Open data.
Yeah. You know, now.
You opened the subject about, about best practice.
Yes, and it's good. Because it's a very big issue of corporate governance. It's called the open data movement. Mm. Meaning, we're not going to discuss if you're going to open all your data or not, because this is private enterprises. There are some issues of IPR here. There are issues that, you know, competition might not like that, or you might not like it for your competition. But one way or another, you must have, you should have, it's better that you have, an open data strategy. Meaning, the question is there. What are you going to do with your data? How is going to stay inside, or how much is going to stay to go outside?
And that has to do with corporate governance.
Of course, it's a central, one of the central issues in your agenda should be this. As it is right now, in every government as well, every government thinks, what do I have to do with my data? It started as an open data movement from the government. Okay.
From the local authorities.
For us now, for you, for corporate enterprises, this is an important issue because, as Christopher said, you know, clarity and openness is very good for your collaborative, collaborating organization, for your network. Networks like that. Okay, maybe the individuals and everybody would not like that, but so you have to stake and to put your barriers. But this is a strategy. You have to think about each item, each data item that
to
that
be
you have,
more open and transparent.
Is it going okay. to be open? Now, blockchain. If you decide to be more open than usual, meaning doing some crazy things.
Like?
I'm going to give you an example, since you like examples. Imagine I'm a professor at the university. Okay, what data do I have? Nothing. I have data of students. Still, this is something. So, if I want to make the idea of, and usually people make resumes, CVs, and they ask for my recommendation. Think about this very small example. If we put that in the blockchain, this would mean that when you make your CV and you are an individual, then all these elements, all these events in your life would be put into a chain of data in a way that you would not be able to alter so easily. Meaning, when you give your CV
That's
to me...
That's one of the advantages of blockchain.
Of course.
Wow. Because
blockchain means fully distributed. Who has access to building your CV? Me as the professor. I say, yes, Malas was a good guy, but you know, she was cheating a little bit. It's there. You cannot remove it so easily. You can ask me and say, Yanis, don't kill me like that. Maybe I come back and say, okay. I will make another action. But even the first one will stay there forever. That once the professor said, yes, you were cheating. And then you go to your first employee, and then you go to your second employee, and then. Imagine now this being a company. Would you like all these reviews by your customers, by your employees, by your network, by the managers, by the shareholders, by everyone, to be in a way so open that you cannot even alter forever? Of course, this will make it as credible as never. But think about it. This is the power of blockchain, eh? It can be distributed, very open, and then, of course, you could say, okay, look, it's not that anyone knows everything. Blockchain has also the possibility, the capabilities to filter. You know, I have a few bitcoins or parts of bitcoins, but you don't know that. You cannot know that. You will never find that out. I know the blockchain keeps this small amount I have, and it's credible. So there are filtering.
So blockchain, the corporate governance, could be used as a ledger, because it's a ledger that you can have written. Everything has to do with a company, right?
Yes.
Okay.
To finish with me, I didn't say this is the one. There are 1 million possibilities now.
Mm. Give us some more examples. Or
no,
Marinos
let the others.
And,
I will not speak
George.
All the time. I gave you one, but this is one of 1 million possibilities. This was of the category, let's say, of identity.
Okay.
There are other categories of registries, of voting, of events, of healthcare, of supply chain. 1 million possibilities.
And one more thing is smart contracts, which is part of blockchain.
Another category
that allows...
Yeah, but how can you use that in corporate governance zone?
You know that one part of the upper management it is that they are taking some bonus or whatever when they achieve some targets. Targets are related to the increase of income or the revenues, but some they are related to
they are more relativity
to the business, saying that I was expand my business in more countries or whatever.
Yeah, okay.
So if I can put all this information in a blockchain and having a smart contract there that say if you manage
achieve that,
then you will take whatever bonus.
And
this will
that
be done
will be automatically.
Automatically without having anybody to and this of course will be based on information that they are written in blockchain and nobody can change, because if you know that in many Greek companies, like the ones that we mentioned.
The one that, yeah, okay.
Many times. There were many, let's say, financial data there that they say that the company was very good, was healthy, without any problem. But at the end, that when somebody was looking in the detail, it found out that these all were.
Yeah, but who is responsible to write the contract? Because, you know.
Well, the contract is being, let's say, written from the people that actually they are putting these goals, which is again managed, let's say, and they actually, let's say, the board of the.
So the board of directors
can put there and do their consensus on that in order, let's say, to say that this is acceptable and.
Yeah, but just out of curiosity, in that case, the board of directors should understand how blockchain works, or doesn't have to.
No, that doesn't mean. Well, blockchain is a technology. It's something that you can, let's say, display in a more understandable way to them, so they don't have to know the underneath okay. technology. They just to know that okay, I have one screen. Let's say make it more easier that I can put votes there or some ticks there, and with that the technology will transform that to the contract or the necessary contract.
Okay, Mr. Karamanoulis, something to add here?
One example was interesting about the open data. As we can see, the open data movement started from US, and then banks, in essence, what they did, they had to follow the PSD2 and open banking regulations. So remember, the open concept, the open technology, open data, and open APIs is something that will disrupt also other markets. They are now formulating policies in European level for the telco and for the insurance industry. So this is one thing, the openness, both at the technology level and at the business level. The second is that blockchain technology could act as a middleware that will could integrate and connect with existing legacy systems, for example, with an ERP or with a procurement management system or an ISO management and monitoring system that does not exist.
Okay. So it can work like an anti
yes, and externalize not the data inside of the organization, but the cryptographical hashes of this mm-hmm. data. So I can check if this data are real, valid, etc., but without having access to this data. So we have to explore this kind of architectures.
So we're talking about some new solutions that the board of directors. What you are saying, more or less, just an example, is that
I can provide every data stream of my organization, the invoices, the contracts on a blockchain ledger, but without revealing and exposing
the
sensitive data, but only the encoded hashed data.
So a shareholder, for example, can
an auditor can audit.
An audit can see if it's true or not.
Yes.
Okay, and have that perception. So we're talking about audit, voting. We said about smart contracts. We said some. Is there something more in blockchain?
Yeah, I mean, is there something more?
I'm talking about. Look, I'm looking for examples in order for people to understand. Yeah. Because okay, we're talking about blockchain. How many people understand what is blockchain? More or less, yeah, that's the right answer.
One and a half,
that's the right answer.
We know him. Mm. The one who said, yes, we know.
No, he doesn't understand blockchain. Mm.
He's participant to Hellenic
Blockchain Hub events. I'm also a participant in the Hellenic Blockchain Hub, and I'm telling
you. Everyone is participant.
But I think that's a really important point, because you asked, the directors need to understand this. The board of directors need to understand this. And talking about sharing data and going back to governance, you know, where there have been issues with companies, not just here, but in the UK and elsewhere, and particularly audit issues, what blockchain can be is a record of information through the company that goes all the way up to the board of directors, to an audit board and to the auditor. And it doesn't need the entire board to be necessarily focused on the entire accounts of a company, but still boards can see directly into the ledger of the company and can understand the financial health And that can help resist things like fraud. So that's a huge initiative. So that's not something that's going to be here tomorrow or next week, because it would be massive for a big company to integrate those kinds of information, you know, into their system. But I think it can be a powerful governance tool to help resist problems at boards in the future. And certainly if I were a company that maybe suffered that in the past, or for one reason or another wanted to demonstrate more robust audit practices, that's certainly something I'd look at. But the boards need to understand that. We talked earlier about board composition and that sort of board composition toolkit. And I think, yes, if you're a company looking at that, first of all, you do need to start, you need to, I mean, you want one director who at least has some experience in digital technology, I think. And if you're going to use that as an audit tool, well, you need a director who can understand it enough to understand where it works and how it might be manipulated for it to be really powerful. So I think people do need to understand it more.
So what you are saying is that from now on, the board of directors need to have someone that's more tech savvy than the average, right?
I mean, does every board need it right now? Maybe not. I mean, and it's certainly not a job for me to opine on. And there are other people in the room who are far better qualified to decide.
They're happy about that. They want to be board of board members.
Oh, well, there you go.
We are the board of directors of a technology company, but the challenge here is for the CEOs to understand the value of digital transformation plans. Of course, to enable the CEO.
Yeah, but we're talking about the digital transformation of corporate governance as well. Mm-hmm. What we're saying now is that more or less digital technology is affecting corporate governance. That's the so, in that sense, you really need to know. You really need to understand how to take advantage of this kind of new technologies in order to provide better corporate governance. Am I right about that?
I think you know. Who needs to know right now? I mean, probably if you're a company secretary working in, you know, in any sort of large size corporate issuer, I think it helps to at least know what technology is out there, how you can support your IR teams, your boards, to help them do their job. And maybe that's the kind of area where you don't need to know everything about the technology, but you should know what's available, know what's coming up, and understand how you can take advantage of it. But long term, if you're a company that really wants to pursue, for one reason or another, a true digital transformation strategy, then you know, really perhaps you do need to start thinking about board makeup and whether you have the right tools to take advantage of that technology.
Okay. Is there any questions? Because I'm talking too much. Someone wants to ask something here? Fine. I think we can hear. All right. I will make the conversation.
All right. Thanks very much. It's been very, very interesting.
Wait a minute. Yeah. Because the ladies in the back cannot hear you.
So, okay. Thanks again for this panel. It's been very interesting. I have
your name?
Francesco Navarino from PERC. So I want to ask two questions. Well, one and a half, they're related. So the first one is, well, as a proxy advisor, sometimes, and I'm talking about the board quality of or the nomination, or you know, I'm just linking to what Mr. Kelly just said. So it's difficult to understand if companies really do their own due diligence when evaluating the board, finding out where are the blind spot or soft spots really, and then actually nominating the right person at the right time to cover that spot. So. There is normally companies do undertake an annual evaluation of the board. The result is seldom available. The outcomes are even more seldom available. And then at a certain point they say, well, we have a rotation and we have decided to appoint this person. And then you don't know where this person comes from. So my first question is, do you think that artificial intelligence can be used in evaluating the board, recruiting the right person, finding out what is the real need of the company in 5, 10, 25 years, recruiting the right person? There is already some evidence of artificial intelligence used in recruiting.
So automating the whole procedure, that's more or less what
you're saying. Making artificial intelligent, yes.
If you're using artificial intelligence, means that it's more automatic.
Yeah, more automatic.
Not more credible, really. He wants to make it.
Yes. One's more credible, but also if you're using AI, it's more automated, right?
We always need, there will always be a human factor for this, for the very reason that we're all here. I mean, there will always be directors because there will always be human beings until machines do not win the war against us. But that's exactly. And my second question is, so if we accept the first, can actually blockchain be used to track and, well, saving confidential information, but track border assessment, evaluation, recruitment, and you know the whole process that went to the up to the nomination, so tracking, making it available, saving confidential information, and making it more credible. Do you have an opinion on that?
Someone wants to answer. I think the professor.
On the second issue, it's even better than what you think. There is already some publicity around it. I'm not sure it's coming from US. I think it's coming from Hong Kong, but you can check.
There is a director in Hong Kong. I mean,
on putting issues around the validity or the status of the board members in a blockchain and their activities when they were, because you see.
But they haven't selected the board members based on AI, right?
No. I'm talking about the second first.
Okay.
The blockchain. Blockchain is ideal. Is an exact example of what I was saying about my students. Here we're talking about a guy who earns, let's say, a couple of hundred or more per year, 1,000 euro per year, and wants to have his credibility and his skills, let's say, and the assessment of the companies. You know, sooner or later, all important hires will be based on some kind of blockchain registry because of the mumble jumble that is happening in the market.
Now it's based on social media. That's
the problem. And sometimes the shareholders do not like that anymore. They say, okay, yeah, okay, Korn Ferry, and then why?
So that's what he's saying. He's saying that using artificial intelligence, but
now,
in order to work, that will need a lot of data.
On the first issue, I think it would be also very, very possible this thing to happen. Try Adzuna. See Adzuna. Adzuna, you can put your CV in Word, MS Word, in Adzuna. It's a company in UK. And you get a fair estimation of what is your price of your working per year in a company right now.
I have to do that.
Do that. I did it. And it's really good. It's really good. It works. Of course, you might be looking at different things. But in general, let it be known, because this is, you're going around this question all the time. You see, artificial intelligence, blockchain, maybe also Internet of Things, that everyone here will start saying, I'm a glass, and yes, you can IP. These three things, it looks like we're talking about the new mega disruptors. The problem with these disruptive technologies is that, first, if you don't know them, not in full extent, but certainly understand what it is and what it can do for you, you know, you will miss the transforming element.
It's like what happens with the internet 20 years ago.
Yeah, but think about enterprises here. We have one enterprise that says, one board is here. This board says, okay, I'll have Malas and his friends, maybe Xinarianos, George, will come as employees. They know something. We don't have to know everything. This is one board. And this, okay, they will do their best. Then we have a second board that says, yes, we appointed George, he wants to be appointed, as a CIO in the board. So he's member there. We have George in the board. But you know, George is one person in the board. The board has a meeting every now and then, not always. And then we have a third board that says, guys, with these mega disruptors, we need all of them to know. It's not a big deal. You know, if you piggyback me for a week, you will learn everything I know about blockchain because it's not so much. Don't be afraid about blockchain. He knows, and come on, it's a weekend. But it's a weekend that you will spend 24 hours per day on that. And then the next Monday, you can go and say, I know.
So because blockchain and AI.
It's not a huge knowledge. But the third board will do what? You see, the third board will invent Bitcoin. The second board will just use blockchain for open data or for something they were doing. the first in the best of solution, in the best of our story, let's say, will do as good as the second. But sometimes they will miss the train completely because their employees will say, why should I do that? You see, it's okay. A decision that the CEO and the president of the board will take over golf saying, hey, would you like to join Libra?
No.
This decision is not going to be taken by low-level employees and by one member of the board. He will never be able to push it. But they know and they say, we want to revolutionize our business completely. So don't look about applications of blockchain. Think about applications of blockchain in your own business. There are thousands.
So it's
already
different from business to business. Okay.
No, I said it's a mega disruptor. It's not only for doing the same thing better. It's here to make you do completely different things and also earn completely different amounts of money.
Someone wants to add something to the answer?
I'd say it's not all about the technology. So for that to work, I think you even mentioned you need enough disclosure, you need enough underlying data. So taking the problem of understanding where the soft spots of a company are, I mean, we talked earlier about disclosures here and elsewhere. And if those disclosures are inaccurate or too small, then potentially that does become more difficult. So I think there are challenges around there. And I think also AI is not there yet in understanding absolutely everything. Some things it's really good at, but understanding the more difficult areas of company strategy and direction, and assessing how well equipped a company is to do that, you know, it may be maybe a while before, say, an AI tool can really do that job well. But it's not to say that that kind of technology doesn't have something to add, with the with the right analysis.
Is it available, the technology?
Is
it available right now?
It's available. Interestingly, I think blockchain and AI are perhaps almost two ends of the spectrum. Blockchain, actually, absolutely, if you spend a little bit of time, you can understand it fairly well. You know, you might not want, it's more difficult to get into the underlying maths of it. But really, the actual technology powering blockchain has been around since the 80s. It's what powers encryption on the internet and lots of other things that are useful to understand generally. But AI is at the very much the other end of the spectrum. For you to really take advantage of it, you need very bright people, professors and similar, who can really understand the tools and understand some quite complex
understand the technology in order to provide the tools.
In order to create something useful. Today there's nothing that you can pull out of a vendor or a shop. There's no freeware that you can go to really produce good results.
Yeah, but what the professor was saying before that was that you need to understand the technology. Blockchain or AI or whatever digital technologies is out there, IoT or whatever, but how you're going to implement in the corporate governance, it could be different from company to company, right?
Well, possibly. Yeah, some companies will take a different direction.
Because he said to me, "Don't take examples." That's what he said. I don't know if you agree with that, as well. Just to put you,
I can tell you that I agree totally on that the technology needs to be adopted in a different way
on different institutions and corporations.
To the question that if AI can actually decide and
help to the decision,
it's something that we have to see if we have data about that. And this everything has to do with data.
Okay.
Because in order to be educated and provide good examples, it needs data. If the data that we have are poor, we get a poor, result. Okay. So I would say that if we, in the future, if we were able to make a usage of both technologies, having data that they are written in blockchain, that they are immutable, that they cannot be changed, and using this data in a way through the AI, maybe this will give us the opportunity to provide better, results regarding the selection. But I don't know if the technology will be something that it will be done in a short period. And this is my opinion about that.
Yeah, of course. Mr. Kamaras, want to add something?
Oh, there are great opportunities for the organizations to implement digital transformation plans. I would also add to this conversation the RPA concept, the robotic process automation concept. Yeah. This is an old process, an old concept where we integrate different information systems and automate things. For example, the payroll with the HR, etc., and public sector.
And you can and use
this,
that.
Yes, and all these disrupting and emerging concepts, AI, blockchain, and RPA, could transform the legacy organizations into modern, open, agile, digital and enabled organizations.
All the hype words you said right now.
So I think this is the challenge.
Can I add?
But when I said hype words, right?
Yes, but because we are saying hype words, but I can tell you that the majority of the Greek, let's say, companies, most of them, they don't know these words. I mean, the small and medium, let's say, enterprises. They are not. They don't know these words because they are. Paying more attention, let's say, that and they use technology that give them the ability to earn more profit or, let's say, to okay. be more...
And the second opportunity after this OpenX buzzword trends, etc., is to connect and integrate the human network, the human capital in Greece from academia, developers, designers and the community in general by operating innovation labs. This is the concept to enable the innovation and the communities to create fast track results, quick wins for these emerging technologies that could be included in a long term strategic plan
innovation
for the organization.
Lab. We'll come to that. Is there any other question? Someone? No.
You're tired.
Huh? They're tired. Yeah, so I will go for one last comment from each of you because I think we have like something like 7 minutes. It's the first time in a Greek conference that everything has gone on time. Don't say a thing, you. Okay, so one last thing. Okay, and I want a comment from all of you. And I will start with Mr. Kamaras because you talked about innovation lab. So do you see that we can have examples of how to use digital technologies, blockchain, RBA or whatever now? Is there in your innovation labs that you run, have you seen some stuff that's going on that can be implemented right now? Yes, are there any examples?
Yes, a lot of examples. For example, three startup companies are implementing the health record management system using a blockchain. But they are trying to design a module that will enable insurance companies and the health industry in general in order to be more transparent. So this is something they are working on. One other example is a civic government tech startup that is in the process to implement also an added value services on top of the Clarity project that already exists. So there is a discussion. Also, I would like to mention that Hellenic Blockchain Hub has collaborated with the Union of Greek Federation of Greek Enterprises, and we have formulated an initial study, a policy paper on how blockchain technology and, in general, distributed ledger technologies. Blockchain is a part of family. Could improve services sectors. Both in public and private sector. So this study will be available soon. And in this study, there are a lot of Greek examples, startup companies and private sector that they are trying to prototype and pilot this type of
activities. Some projects about using technology. Okay, Mr.
Xenariana. I would tell
for
you
the
that
corporate governance or
for the corporate governance,
I would say that in Greece I haven't seen something that it's close to that. On the other hand, there are a lot of people that they are working or they are familiar, let's say, with this technology. There are a lot of engineers there, so I think could be interested if we can build up some hackathons or some
for competitions
for corporate governance in order, let's say, to put, because always you have to put a question in order to find an answer.
And challenges.
And challenges, of course. If you don't put the question there, nobody will, because, okay, corporate governance is something that most of the, let's say, people in the universities, they don't know very well. They know management, they know very well all these things, but corporate governance is something that they learn when they go.
That's a pass for Mr. Halabrith, I think. Have you seen anything?
I will cut the statement,
yeah,
put it online in Harvard, and say, people in universities.
I'm saying the Greek universities, not okay.
I was 10 years in the board of directors of Singular. To be honest, I learned a lot, but even more I learned about issues of enterprises when I said, I want to study this. You see, between you and knowledge is only will. And this is for anyone, not only for the universities. I mean, I'm not afraid my fellow professors, I'm afraid the students. Even the students can know more than anyone here who has been a board member, if they are board members, for years. Even a student, even in 1 week,
because they have
student,
Google. If they didn't have a Google, they wouldn't know.
Forget about it, that knowledge is in the board and the experience, but that's another discussion. Now, okay. I kept a few notes. Some Greek companies, yes, have in mind, as we speak, of course, AI is not a main trend yet in Greek companies, but I know of some Greek companies, as I also do about blockchain, that as we speak, maybe they're not here now, but as we speak, they do work. They do tremendous exercises, and they are well known. There is not hidden somewhere. Mm-hmm. They are well, Greece is, you know, European Union. Coca-Cola is here, you know, Volkswagen is here. And we have so many multinationals. It's not so easy anymore to say, you know, Greek companies lag behind. No, I'm not afraid of, I was never
that.
Afraid.
I'm asking for examples of how to use in Greece from the three of you abroad. From
things are happening
but
day
focus
by day.
On, day by day. Governance.
On corporate governance,
yes.
Yeah.
Now,
that's corporate, the main of, it's so corporate governance.
Okay, summit. Okay. So, second issue. You asked about examples and Look, as we understood, blockchain with this nature of being distributed, so many people have access to it, and also being closed, but in a way that you cannot forfeit. Have that in mind. If you are corporate governance guys, you can understand the repercussions. Everything that you need to verify within the company borders can be verifiable for years. For corporate governance, any malpractice, if you decide, call me in your company and say, Yaris, give me some ideas about blockchain in corporate governance. AI also, AI can play a very big role, and don't be so pessimistic about AI. You know, I have this game, I give you a small gift. When you are not really sure if AI can do the job on something, you ask the one who does the job. So there is a guy there, I say, it's only persons that can do that. And then you say, okay, I will sue you. Sue means, you know, accuse you really hardly. I do that in the public sector very often. I go to a public sector organization and they tell me, yes, you know, we cannot do that with machines because this is humans. I say, okay, show me the human. There's a small team. Say, you guys, I accuse you, you go to jail because you do things on your own. And immediately when you accuse someone like that, they say, no, Yanis, we have lists here, we follow procedures, we have algorithms. We
say, so if you have algorithms and procedures, you can do that with machines.
Give that to me. So whenever someone says to you, you know, this cannot be done, this is based on humans, say, okay, then I put you on the line how you chose this guy to be a member of the board. Because if you don't have a rationale, you're bound to be accused. So he would say, no, we have a matrix, we have things, we are taking things. It's not a personal issue. And then you say, okay, give me that. It doesn't work all the time. But for many times, it works pretty much okay.
Okay.
And the last thing because you're looking for my last thing.
Yeah, I'm all looking the time. For your last thing.
The last thing is...
you talk more than me, which it's is perfect. Difficult.
I'm a professor.
Yeah, yeah, I know. No.
Not started lessons yet. So this is an accumulated...
That's the word,
it's,
yeah, okay.
It's the summer period. You see, now we start next week, so I will be fine. Yes, if you have ideas and you cannot make them true, okay, there are ideas and things that... I don't know. You come to your fellow professor. I have many students, many, meaning more than 100 students all the time, wanting to do a kind of diploma thesis with real enterprises. Easier. Send me an email.
Okay. Thanks very
Next.
Much. Finishing up.
Yeah, so I guess I have a slightly different view as to particularly near-term opportunities. So there are real corporate governance stuff out there. I mean, I talked before about managing the general meeting,
yeah,
and communication with shareholders. And I think there's a lot of opportunity for the board shareholder interaction, with shareholders being quite dispersed and they're not necessarily, I mean, clearly not part of the company, they're not part of that network. So blockchain in particular can help grease the wheels of the communication between shareholders and boards and companies. And I think there's lots of very real, very practical technologies. Some of them that are out there, even Tallinn Stock Exchange has its own blockchain general meeting process. We have our own technology for that as well. So there are real technologies in that direction. Also, investors are already starting to take advantage of AI to understand companies. And companies can make themselves better understood by making sure they're disclosing things in a more friendly way, so that they can be read and consumed by individuals, but also increasingly over time by AI. So I think those are probably the real near-term opportunities for these kind of technologies in corporate governance. I think integrating that kind of data flow up into the boards of directors is a complete revolution for a company. And I think really, if companies are looking at data, I think more likely, and there are lots of examples of companies that are looking, talked about open data before, about how to reuse the data. And it's not necessarily a question of, is it, you know, is that data open or not? But also, for a large company, how can I expose the data in this silo to the rest of the company? Mm. And how can I take advantage of that? And we've seen that a lot in banks, exposing data from one location to another, or from one department to another. So that something simple like asset servicing corporate actions, that, you know, providing that corporate actions information to front office has been reused in other kind of financial opportunities. And I think those are probably the real sort of more near-term opportunities for data management strategies. But of course, over time, as more departments integrate their data into central solutions, it seems sensible to make sure there's a long-term plan for a holistic company data strategy. And over time, after that transformation, I'm sure all of those things, as I say, exposing that data into boards in a way that they can easily consume and analyze, and in a way that is impervious to fraud, I think is something that may well happen. But I think that is, you know, several years away at best, really, to be honest. You okay. know, not that I'm terribly critical.
Thanks very much. Yeah. Thanks, everybody. Χειροκρότημα, παρακαλώ. Thank you very much.